Hello, and welcome to Adventures in Neuropathology with your favorite neuropathologist, Andrea Gilbert. So today I have an interesting case to show you. This is a case of a metastatic breast cancer, but for the pathology residents out there, I think it would be a good idea to approach your cases without knowing what the diagnosis is, without knowing what other people's opinions are. So let's pretend like you don't already know what the diagnosis is, and let's take a look. Okay, so the image that we have here is a image that's depictive of a tumor in the brain. And so for the pathology residents out there, whenever you look at a slide, as soon as you put that slide on the stage, you want to make an assessment on where you are in the body. So are you in the CNS? And if so, where? And here we have a very nice depiction of a specific location within the body, specifically within the CNS. So can you see where we are? So let's take a look, okay? So we've got this nasty looking thing here. It's a very atypical, obviously tumor situation going on down here. But what is this tissue up here? Can you recognize it? This is cerebellum, okay? So what we have here, this is the molecular layer. This is the internal granule cell layer here, this heavily cellular area, and then sandwiched in between the molecular layer and the internal granule cell layer is the Purkinje cell layer, and we might see a little Purkinje cell right there. Now, So you don't have to wait for the surgeon to tell you where you are. We can see where we are just looking at the tissue. So let the tissue talk to you, okay? Now, we've also got this this lesion here, and it's a pretty bad looking lesion. This grungy pink area here, this is necrosis. We've got necrosis here, necrosis here, necrosis here. So this is a really bad looking tumor, okay? Now notice here that the border between the tumor and the non-neoplastic brain tissue, this border is really, really well delineated. So in a diffuse glioma or most other primary lesions that arise from the CNS, usually that border is going to be much more diffuse. Even for your circumscribed gliomas like pilocytic astrocytomas, PXA skin gliomas, those are characteristically circumscribed. Even those will have a little bit of an infiltration into the surrounding non-neoplastic brain tissue. But with metastatic disease, very characteristically, for the most part, metastatic disease is going to have this very sharp border between the tumor and the non-neoplastic tissue. For the radiologists out there and the surgeons, when you look at the radiology here, you can see that there's usually a pretty well-defined border. This is very much highlighted on the mass spectroscopy. And so that is highlighting the border between the disease and the non-neoplastic surrounding brain tissue. Now, this can be a little bit blurred on the T2 flare, where sometimes you can get a lot of edema kind of blurring that well-delineated border. But with the mass spectroscopy, I think it's a really good example of highlighting that very strong, very sharp border between the neoplastic and the non-neoplastic tissue. And so that's what we're seeing here. That's what we see on histology. So we've got a very sharp, very well delineated border between the metastatic tissue, the metastatic tumor, and then the non-neoplastic brain tumor, the non-neoplastic brain tissue. And so this is very characteristic of metastatic disease. So I want to go a little bit closer into this area here. Oh, okay. Into this area here, and we can see again this very sharp border between the tumor and the non-neoplastic cerebellar tissue here. We can see in the non-neoplastic cerebellar tissue that we've got these little glomeruli, and these are the internal granule cells. These are not lymphocytes. To the pathology residents out there, you always want to be very careful about calling lymphocytes in brain tissue. These are not lymphocytes. These are neurons as part of the internal granule cell layer. Okay, so for the tumor here, we can see that this tumor, even though it looked really, really nasty from high power, and we can see a lot of areas of necrosis, when you look at the individual tumor cells, they don't look crazy terribly pleomorphic, and that is very characteristic for breast cancer. Another very characteristic finding for breast cancer is where we have these ductal-looking proliferation of cells. It looks like if you had cells kind of growing down a duct and you cut it in cross-section and you look at that two-dimensional plane of the cross-section, you would see a circular lesion as it was going down that that tubular structure, the ductular structure. And so we can see that it makes this kind of circular lesion or this circular appearance on a two-dimensional plane. And then in the center here, we have this necrosis that's surrounded by these neoplastic cells. This necrosis is has a very characteristic name to them. This is called comedonecrosis. This is very characteristic of breast cancer. Okay, so if we move on to next location, I just want to showcase this area right here, and we'll take a closer look. Again, there's a lot of necrosis here, and we can see the central necrosis here as well. And you can see that this tissue, it kind of forms this kind of duct structure. Again, if you take a three-dimensional structure of a tubular structure and you cut it straight down the center, if you look at that cross-section, it's going to look like a circle with a center inside, and that's what we're seeing here. We're seeing this kind of circle, and we can see the outline here of the tumor cells that are trying to recapitulate growing as a duct. And in the center here, we can see this comedonecrosis here. So this is a very characteristic appearance of ductular carcinoma arising from the breast. Ductular carcinoma is the most common cancer arising from the breast. You can also get other cancers from the breast like globular, et cetera, et cetera. But ductular is by far the most common. When we see this metastatic disease, it's very commonly, it's going to look like this. Okay. So, here's another example of just the tumor cells looking up close and personal. There is a little bit of pleomorphism here, but notice that it's not crazy atypical pleomorphism. So this is a moderately differentiated tumor in that if we look at the architecture and we look at the cellular features, we can make out that this arose from a ductular breast carcinoma. So well to moderately differentiated, you can tell that what the lesion of origin was, what the tissue of origin was. For poorly differentiated tumors, it's really hard to tell what the tissue of origin was. For well and moderately differentiated tumors, it's a lot easier to say, oh, this arose from breast, or this arose from GI, or this arose from kidney, etc., etc. But with the poorly differentiated tumors, it's really hard to tell where this tumor arose from. And so in cases where it's really hard to tell, or in cases where we just want to prove that it is breast cancer, we can do some immunostains. So here we have on the right side, this is tumor, on the left side, this is non-neoplastic brain tissue. Again, we can see the internal granule cell layer. These little glomeruli are highlighted in negative relief here. And this is normal cerebellum here. And then here on the right side, we've got immunohistochemistry of the tumor. And this specifically is estrogen receptor immunohistochemistry, and it's highlighting the tumor. So this tumor is ER positive. In addition, we also have a PR stain, and the PR is not as robust, but it is positive. So we've got a breast cancer here that is ER PR positive. We would also do the HER2. I don't have that here because that comes out a little bit later. But we would also do the HER2. So these are the important certain hormone stains that you need to do with every breast cancer, and it's important to say whether or not the ER or the PR is positive, because that is going to inform treatment. Okay, so there are specific treatments that can be done in patients that are hormone positive that cannot be done or are not going to be effective in patients that are hormone negative. And sometimes the original tumor might not always match up with the metastatic tumor. So when you look at the original tumor and the original tumor was ERPR positive, that doesn't necessarily dictate that the metastatic tumor is going to be ERPR positive as well. So you need to double check that just to make sure. In addition, you need to double check what the previous tumor showed so that you can make a correlation in saying that, okay, if this ERPR is negative, was the original tumor ERPR negative too? And then therefore that doing the ERPR isn't really going to help you. In those circumstances, then you can do other immunostains like GATA3 and so forth and so forth. But for the most part, the ERPR is going to be one of the very first things that you want to do in a person where you're suspecting breast cancer. Okay, so the diagnosis for this case was a metastatic breast cancer. To the non-medical folks out there, metastatic means, or metastasis means, that a tumor started in one area of the body and then it moved to another area of the body and is now growing in a different area of the body. So in this case, we have a breast cancer. It is a ductular carcinoma that arose in the breast, then it traveled through the blood system and ended up in the brain and then started growing in the brain. As a word of caution to the pathologists out there, if you have a patient who has breast cancer, a known history of breast cancer, and then they come up with a lesion in their brain, oftentimes you won't get a biopsy of that tissue, because the assumption is that if the breast cancer, if the patient has a history of breast cancer and then it traveled to the brain and now she's got a new lesion in the brain, the assumption is that's probably metastatic disease. So oftentimes the clinicians will just go ahead and treat. So they might zap it with radiation and you won't see a biopsy there. In times where you will see a biopsy is in a patient who has had a prior breast cancer, she had a lesion arise in the brain, they zapped that lesion with radiation, and now what you're seeing is a new change or a new alteration on MRI imaging. And so what they're wondering is this a radiation necrosis type lesion, or is it a recurrence type lesion? Those are the situations where you might get a biopsy. And in fact, this is what happened with this patient. She had metastatic disease. It went to the brain. She had it zapped with radiation, and then she had an alteration in her MRI imaging features. And the question was this radiation necrosis or was this actual breast cancer a tumor process? And the answer is it's tumor. So that's going to be the main question, radiation necrosis versus tumor in patients who have had metastatic disease and had that disease treated with radiation. Okay, so if you feel like you learned something in this video, or if you enjoyed this video, please feel free to subscribe. You can also find us on our webpage, Adventures in Neuropathology. We're also present on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. So be sure to check us out. So we'll see you next time on Adventures in Neuropathology. Thanks.